morning is hard for a lot of preachers to get, and a lot of controversy about what I'm going to say today. There's some different beliefs, and there'll be people who hear this sermon really, really vehemently disagree with some things I'm going to say. And it needs to be taught, it needs to be preached. Hebrews chapter number 12. We'll look at verse number 3 and read several verses down there. I want you to keep your Bibles open as we'll be returning to this scripture. Hebrews 12, verse 3. For consider him that endureth such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your mind. Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. And ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. Remember that. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. If ye endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the Father chasteneth not? A lot of them like it now. Verse 8, but if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. Notice how the devil will take a Bible word and make a cuss word out of it. That's not a cuss word in the Bible sense, just like hell and damn are not in the Bible sense. And you're a bastard and not a real son of God. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh, our earthly fathers, which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For they verily for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure. But he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. Isn't that something? Verse 11. Now, no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous. That means it ain't fun while you're getting a whipping. No chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward, it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. The Bible calls this the chastening of the Lord. The chastening of the Lord. The Bible talks about chastening. That's discipline. Over and over and over. 2 Corinthians 6 and verse 9 said, as chastened and not killed. Way back in Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 5, the Bible said, as a man chasteneth his son, so does God. The Bible said in Psalm 94:12, blessed is the man whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and correcteth. One said that they don't believe that. I talked to a boy one day who was a preacher. He said, you talk about God chastening. He said, that's not right. He said, the Lord don't do that because Jesus paid for all of our sins when he died on the cross. Now, that guy don't understand his Bible. You got to understand the difference between state and standing. Jesus did pay for all of our sins on the cross. When God chastens us, it's not us paying for our sins. It's him correcting us and putting us in line. It's what the Bible said. The Bible said in Proverbs 3:12, whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth, even as a father the son in whom he delighteth. In plain English this morning, if you're really, really saved, the Lord is going to correct you when you get out of line. The Bible said he scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. Now, there's some kids that get more whippings than others. There's some kids that need more whippings than others. I got some when I was growing up, but how many would agree with me and say, I didn't get as many as I really should have? Raise your hand. That's right. Most of the truth is you got away, or you thought you got away with a lot, and probably didn't get as many as you thought you did. Now, this is, a man told me one time, he said, you can't say the Lord whips his children. That's, the Lord don't beat his wife. The preacher ought to understand the Bible better than that. Number one, we're not his wife yet. We're engaged to him to be married to Jesus Christ. And number two, the Bible talks about God dealing with us as sons. We not only have a marriage relationship with Jesus, we have a son and father relationship with God also. And there's lots of different ways he deals with us. He dealeth with us as with a son. And the world has come up with all kinds of new ways to discipline, and you know, talk to the child, you know, and try to help them to understand what makes them do what they do. But the Bible way is chastening. Now, chastening don't always mean whipping with a switch or with a rod. Sometimes chastening comes in the form of a rebuke from the Word of God. And then if you don't listen, it gets worse and worse. I knew a man who was getting into sin. He's messing around with something he shouldn't have been messing with. Somebody shouldn't have been messing with. And they went to a camp meeting and heard a preacher preach. And that preacher got up that night and done everything but call that guy out. And he had no idea. Preacher was from another state. And that preacher, he said, if you play with fire, you're going to get burned. I mean, it was just like wham, wham, wham. Getting hit with that Bible and hit with that Bible. And the man sat there and listened, and he didn't do nothing about it. And it wasn't very long after that till everything blew up right in his face. And he lost everything he had nearly. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the Lord. That's a rebuke. The Lord will rebuke you with the Word of God first. And then if you don't listen, he'll do something else. And then if you don't listen, he'll do something else. Now everybody in here that's saved, I want you to listen to me for a minute. We're talking about your Father dealing with you. You do know that your life is in his hands, don't you? You do understand that he makes your heart beat. He keeps your lungs breathing. You are in his hand. And you are his child. And the Bible said, he scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. There is not one Christian ever who gets through life without having the Lord discipline him and change him. You're not, I'm not, I have been before, and I'm sure I will be again if we stay here long enough. Now let's look at this here just for a minute. And one man said, no, you're wrong, preacher. God don't even see it when I see him. There you go again. You don't understand between judicially and practically. Judicially, the Lord don't see our sins. We're perfect in his sight. Practically, the eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding the good and the evil. If you're a father, you got kids, you know what I'm talking about. I mean, my kids, we're going somewhere, and we're going out to eat, and one of them does something wrong, they're all sitting over there groaning this morning, so I don't whip them as often. But it's been a while. They're all three sitting over there with kids this morning, and you know what? When they would do something, I would... they'd be in trouble. I said, all right, you're going to get it when we get home, right? And then they're in trouble. And then somebody would say, how you doing, Brother Danny? Well, that's my daughter. Hey, I'll buy her dinner. I'll be good to her. That's judicially. Practically, she's going to get it when we get home. And that's the way God deals with us as his children. Now, let's look at a few things about it. Listen, and you'll learn something here this morning. Number one, chastisement is experienced by every true Christian, every one of them, every single one. There's the thorn, there's the knife, there's the Word of God, and then finally, the whip. The Bible said he correcteth a son. It is to correct us, not to punish us. When you discipline your kids a lot of times, you're not wanting to hurt them. You're correcting them so that they'll do better in life and live a better life and turn out better and learn lessons. If you let a kid just run wild and do anything it wants to, you know what's going to wind up, don't you? In jail. Because it thinks it can just do whatever and not answer to nobody. So we've got to understand that every child of God goes through chastening. My parents chastised me. I chastised my kid. There's never been but one kid who did not need it, and it wasn't yours. And I told a lady at Walmart that one day. She said, I've never had to spank my child. And I said, lady, there ain't never been but one kid didn't need a whipping, and it wasn't yours. And it wasn't mine. It was the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Every other child needs a whipping once in a while. Everyone, every single one. They say you should wait a few months for a girl, but much earlier with boys. That's what they say. Proverbs 3 and verse 11 said, my son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. Don't let it bother you when the Lord whips you. The Bible said, let not your soul spare for his crying. The Bible said, he that spareth his rod hateth his child. The Bible said in Proverbs 23:12, withhold not correction from the child. The Bible even said there is a sin unto death. You can even shorten your life by refusing to live right and serve God. So it's experienced by all true Christians. Number two, we are not expected to enjoy it. We are not expected to enjoy it. As a matter of fact, if you enjoy a whipping, there's something wrong with your whipping. I've heard kids saying, I don't care, my daddy spanked me all he wants to. It don't bother me. You know what a kid's problem is like that? They ain't never had a real one. You get a real one, buddy, it'll matter to you if you get another or not. Mama say, I'm going to whip you. I don't care. It didn't hurt last time. She didn't whip you. I've seen them go down the road and say, now, son, put that down. Son, put that down. Son, put that down. And say, I whip him all the time. It don't do no good. He ain't never had a whipping. I'll guarantee you one thing, brother. You will not enjoy a real whipping. You won't enjoy it when the Lord takes you to the woodshed. It is grievous. It is grievous, the Bible said. I mean, he scourged it. Nobody likes it. I didn't like it. I've told you about that time. My daddy come in and got me up. I'd set a fire in the basement with a little cigarette lighter. And my mom told him, I was in the bed asleep, had sweet dreams, minding my own business. All of a sudden, the light come on, brother. Something grabbed me right there. And I went straight up like that right there, just dangling. And just started going, wham, wham, wham. I mean, I thought I died and went to hell. I thought, good night. I thought, Lord, have mercy, he's going to kill me. Do you think I enjoyed that? No chastening seemeth. I mean, it hurt. It hurt. You say, was your daddy trying to kill you? No, he was correcting me. I never did set another fire in the basement. See, that's what a whipping's for. That's what a whipping's for. So when God comes down on you and the Lord, don't, the Bible said, neither faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth. See, if you don't preach that and you don't believe that, you're leaving out a huge part of the Christian life and New Testament doctrine, how God deals with us as with sons. I didn't enjoy it when my principal, I think I was one time in the eighth grade, or I've been several times, my elementary class teachers, I'm not recommending this. I'm just telling you how they used to when I was in elementary class. One time there's some nut sat behind me, and we was had rulers and Play-Doh, and this boy behind me took a scissors and cut my ear. He just went right like that and cut my ear right up through there. I have not had my ear pierced. That's a scar from when a guy cut me with scissors. No, I'm just kidding. You know what? That hurt, man. I was bleeding. I was ready to take that ruler and hit that guy in the head with it. And you know what our teachers would do? She'd take our hands into them like that right there and take a ruler and just go, pow, 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 pow. Oh, it hurt. It felt like you put your hand on an iron. And, buddy, I'll tell you one thing. You straightened up right quick. Oh, nowadays, that's horrible. Hitting breeds hitting. If you hit a child, it'll teach them to hit. If you hit them right, it'll teach them not to. I'm telling you, you think you're smart, but you're not going to improve over what God said in that book right there. Let me ask you a question. The fruit's in the proof's in the pudding, brother. Is this generation of kids more well-behaved and respectful than the last generation? Lord have mercy. No comparison. I'll guarantee you one thing. By the time Jonah got out of that whale, he was willing to go preach anywhere God told him to. It was for correction. It wasn't just to punish Jonah, it was to correct him. He wasn't willing to go preach before he went in the whale. After he got out of that whale, buddy, and got his degree from whale. I'm telling you what, brother, my principal called me in the office one time, and I got in some trouble. I don't even remember what it was. And it was Mr. Bird up there, and when I was just in like 7th or 8th grade, he said, Dan, he called me Dan, he said, Dan, my coach and all them, they always call me Castle. All the time they say, Castle this. But he called me Dan for some reason. I hated him calling me that. And, you know, the word Dan means God is my judge. And I was sitting there and he said, Dan. I went, oh, God. He looked at me. I thought, Lord, have mercy. I mean, you couldn't call a lawyer and you know, threaten them and stuff like that. He said, get over here. Bend over here right now. He pulled out a paddle about that long. I'm telling you, oh, my goodness. I mean, and he'd make you bend over, make you. And I'd go over like that right there. And, you just say, here it comes, here it comes. And he'd ride back and go, wham. Knock you off the ground like that. I mean, I'm serious. And you think, how many? Is that 2, 3, 4? Oh! I mean, and oh, you think, okay, finally quit. Somebody say, how many licks do you get? 3. How many licks do you get? 5. And I go back in the class like this. I was sitting them boys say, did it hurt? Nah. I couldn't sit down for an hour. I mean, somebody turned the air conditioner on in here. It felt like it was 110 degrees. You say, oh, that's awful. No, that's awful. I tell you what it said, what it done. It's no chastening seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. You know what? If it had said, all right, Danny, you have time out, I'd have said, yes, that's exactly what I want. Let me out of here. I want to look at you. I won't have to listen to this. I loved it to have time out. What kind of punishment's that? I understand we got your hands tied nowadays. I understand we got school teachers here, and there's nothing you can do about it. But you can do something about your kids. Amen? You can do something about your kids and raise them according to the Bible. Ladies and gentlemen, number 3, here's the hard part for you. There's 2 things when God's whipping you, you got to remember. Don't despise it, and don't faint. Some people despise it. See? Don't regard it lightly. Don't have this attitude when God's whipping you saying, well, stuff happens. It's just life. Well, don't you think the Lord might be? No. Stuff happens to everybody. Don't have that attitude. Now, let me make something real clear here. I'm not the judge as to who is getting a whipping and who ain't. Sometimes people say, well, old so-and-so, buddy, he's getting it. The Lord's whipping him. You don't know that. I don't know. That's none of my business, none of your business. That's between them and God. Sometimes people get persecuted. Sometimes the devil hits people. You can't say everything that happens to somebody is God whipping them. Right? Are we in agreement on that? I know some people say, well, look at that. The Lord sure is getting him. Well, look at that. The Lord sure is getting them. And when it happens to them, they say, boy, the devil's fighting me. How come it ain't the Lord hitting you? You don't know when the Lord. Somebody might be going through. Job went through some hard time, and it wasn't because of anything he was doing wrong. It was because God was testing him. So sometimes it's a test. Sometimes it's a test you go through, or a trial, or some way to prove what you are. But I can't speak for you folks, but I know when the Lord's whipping me. I can tell the difference when it's just the devil or somebody persecuting me or me having to go through trials and when God's whipping me. Now, I'm going to make a confession to you this morning. I don't think I've ever said this in the pulpit. I've been preaching all my life since I was 19 years old. I remember, I don't have no scripture to say this is right, but it seemed like even way back when I was growing up before I got saved, if I went out and done something really bad, something happened every time. I don't know that God does that to lost people. I didn't get saved until I was 18. I knew God. Listen, that time I got shot, or that boy shot me with that gun right there in my hand, that we had been out. I don't remember what we'd done, but we was cussing and raising Cain the night before. Bam! You say, oh, that just happened, that just happened. You're a lot better off to take this attitude of, okay, Lord, okay, I hear you, I get it, than to, oh, it happens to everybody. Bad stuff happens to everybody. Yeah, something else is going to happen to you. Some people don't understand a whooping. A mule don't understand a whooping. Don't despise it. Don't despise it. Don't despise it. Get the message. I mean, listen, people. Is everybody listening? 6 weeks in traction with your feet tied up, trying to get your back straightened out. A kidney stone going to the hospital. You say, well, you can't say God. No, I'm not saying it. I know how it is with me. It seemed like every single time that I ever done anything wrong, right after that, the Lord hit me with something. I believe in it. Believe what you want to. I'm going to say, okay, Lord, I hear you loud and clear. I hear you loud and clear. Problems? You get fired? You have a car wreck? Something bad happened to you? You better learn how to listen. You better learn how to listen to God. Some people, the Lord just beats them to death and they just don't get it through their head. Oh, this is just life. Stuff like this just happens over and 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 over. You reckon God might be trying to tell you something? You reckon God might be dealing with you? There's a man come to town years ago. An old man, he's driving, had a mule pulling this old, ugly, old, outdated wagon. And these smart alecks were standing around there saying, hey, let's make this old man dance. Hey, old man, you ever dance any? He said, no, I don't. And the guy pulled out a six-shooter revolver, started shooting, you know, like cowboys do, shooting at his feet. Bam, 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 bam. And they did doing like that right there. He said, ha, the old man dance you have now, ain't you? That old man, he shot all of his bullets out. Old man reached up in that wagon and pulled out a 12-gauge shotgun. And he put it right in that guy's chest and he said, did you ever kiss a mule? But he didn't say mule. And the guy said, no, but I've always wanted to. Well, then, bam, he got the message right there, see. He got the message right there. Now listen, buddy, you may back big tough. Hey, you might have went and partied last night. God got a 12-gauge shotgun waiting on you, sonny boy. And he knows your number, and he knows how to ring your bell. Don't you forget it. He knows how to get your attention. Don't you think, well, I'm going to go out here and sin, and I'm going to do something wrong, and ain't nobody going to know it. He knows it. He knows it. And if you're really saved, you ain't going to get away with it. Amen? The Bible said you're a bastard and not a child of God. I'm just preaching you the Bible. You ought to appreciate that. Amen? Amen? Number four, you are not to faint. You are not to faint. Don't give up. Can I tell y'all something this morning? Let me tell you the easiest and best way to stay right with God. I know people that go out and sin, bam, something happens. Go out and sin, bam, something happens. You get in trouble, you get arrested, your car get tore up. I'm not saying every time that happens it's God. I'm not saying that. I'm saying I know when it's me. Ask my girls over. Ask them. When something happens to them, and I ask them, I say, you been doing something you shouldn't? And they always say, no. I say, okay. You say, you stay on them like that? Yeah, the downside of that is when something happens to me, they come and say, you been doing something you shouldn't? And if I have, I say, well, as a matter of fact, I have. None of your business. See, God deals with us as with sons. Let me tell you the best way to stay right with God and live a happy, clean, healthy life. You listening? The best way to stay right with God is constantly expose yourself. Listen to me. Constantly expose yourself to sin, hating, Bible-believing, scathing, blasting, loud, clear, plain preaching. That's the way to stay right with. That's the best way to stay right with God. If you go to a church where they don't preach the Bible and they don't tell you what you're doing wrong, I mean, you can get high, smoke that dope, get drunk, act stupid, and it's all right. Leave your wife, desert your family, do whatever you want to. Nothing bad. You're asking for trouble, buddy. And you ain't going to beat God. You ain't going to beat him. You just think you're smart. You just think you're all cool and smart. Me and Lord got a little deal worked out. And Lord just said, well, you know what? I'll get you home. Well, I'll get you home. Don't get mad. It's not his fault. You go somewhere, if you can't get it here, get it on the internet, get CDs, tape, let somebody just preach the full devil out of you constantly. I get it all the time. I listen to preaching every day. I put it in my car. Ask my family if you don't believe it. I put it on at home. Preaching, 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 preaching. You know why? Because I've been to the woodshed. I know what it's like to get a whipping from the Lord. And I'd just rather just keep it clean, keep it right, stay away from things He don't want me to stay away from. Listen, you get whipped good enough, you'll get the message and you'll straighten up. I'll bet you Jonah never did tell God no when he wanted him to preach again. I'll tell you what else I'll bet you. Figure of speech, you understand. I'll bet you by the time David went to the funeral home with that kid and lost four of his kids, that he never messed with a man's wife again. I'll bet you David quit his messing around. Are you listening? I bet you David never did mess with another man's wife. He got hit. You get hit hard enough, you'll straighten up. Problem with some of you people, you just ain't been hit right yet. You still think you're smart. You still think it's somehow or another, it's worth it. Time the Lord take. Listen, the punishment should make the crime not worth it. The punishment make the crime not worth it. Don't faint. Just get up a better, smarter, holier, more determined man. For if you endure chastening, number five, it's always profitable. Like this, people say, well, if God loves me, why did He let this happen? That's exactly why He did, because He loves you so much and trying to correct you. Don't you get me wrong. I'm not saying everything bad happens to you is God with you. I didn't say that. And if you say I said that, you're misquoting me. But sometimes it is. Ladies and gentlemen, you're supposed to be better. The truth is, I look back now and see when I wish I could just talk plainer to you and tell you, I remember one time 25 years ago, I had some kind of sin in my heart or something like that. And so, within hours, tear your car up. You say, oh, it's an accident. That would have happened anyway. If that happens three and four to every time, like, there ain't no accident. I know when God's dealing with me. You can say it ain't God all you want to, believe whatever you want to. You're like that mule, hit you and hit you and hit you. You don't never get it, do you? The Lord keeps hitting you and hitting you. You don't get it through your head. I don't know about you, buddy. I go through life saying, okay, Lord. Now, the truth is, you are going to get sick. Somebody is going to die. Your car is going to die. If you live perfect from now on out. Job was upright and perfect before God and had all kinds of bad things happen to him. I'm not saying you can get through life with nothing bad happening. I am saying you'll have a lot more bad happen to you if you're saved, if you won't live right. That's what I'm saying. He loves you. Jonah was a better man. David was a better man. I know of 5 preachers that said God called them to preach that are no longer on this earth. They died, a young man. One man left his wife, stole another man's wife, married her, lived in sin. He died. Another one, done the same thing, he died. Another one, got into sin, shot himself. I know 2-3 that did that. They're dead. See, you watch that TV and them stupid TV shows that tell you it's all right to be cool and flirt around. It's all right to have a girlfriend or boyfriend on the side. I'm telling you, if you're saved, you've got a Father in heaven that's going to chasten you. Amen. And if you're not, you're not a child of God anyway. You're not even saved. I'm done with that message. I want to tell you something here before I quit. It's unusual for me to do this because it's really, really got nothing to do much with my message because my message is to save people. But I want to close this morning by telling you a story. You know, the O.J. Simpson case has got a lot of attention here lately, and they made a movie out the other day. That's very, very intriguing. It's interesting. You want to study on sin and the results of sin? Look at that Kennedy family. It put O.J. out of business. Have you ever heard of the famous, what they call the Kennedy curse? You ever heard that? It's everywhere. It's all over the world. They even said it themselves. I'm not saying the Kennedys were saved. They were all disciplined, staunch Catholics. And Joe Kennedy, the daddy of all of them Kennedys, they had a dynasty in the 60s. They were worth hundreds of millions of dollars, be billions of dollars. Now, one of the wealthiest families in the country was the Kennedys. Now, don't you listen to me this morning. I'm not saying this is God chastising them because they probably wasn't even saved. They might have been some. I hope there was. I don't know. I'm not saying there was. So this is not God's chastening. This is the results of sin. Let me just read it to you. Joe Kennedy, the old man Kennedy, daughter Rosemary, 23 years old, had surgery and it went completely wrong and she was messed up in the head. That was John Kennedy's sister for the rest of her life. In 1944, Joe Kennedy Jr. died when his plane exploded. Now, I'm going to read you a bunch of these here, but do you know how Joe Kennedy got all his money? Because it was during the years of Prohibition when the sale of alcohol was illegal, and he made his fortune selling liquor. Selling alcohol, ruining families, causing homes to break up, causing suicides, murder. He supplied liquor to them. He was the main distributor of Gordon Dry Gin and Scottish whiskey in this country during Prohibition. In 1963, John F. Kennedy was shot and killed. Everybody knows that one. In 1964, Ted Kennedy was in a plane crash and killed his aide. He survived. In 1968, Robert Kennedy, running for president, was assassinated. In 1969, Ted, with that famous Chappaquiddick accident, run that car off in that river drunk and kill that girl and wouldn't report it for 10 hours that there's a dead girl in his car. And Ted Kennedy said then, there's a curse on the Kennedy family. He hadn't read Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 15, that places a curse on the sale of and distribution of alcohol. Don't sell it. Don't make it. The Bible says, woe to a man that puts a bottle to his neighbor's lips. Woe to that man. God in heaven. Look down. Watch this. Jackie Kennedy had miscarriages, a stillborn, and a baby who died. 1973, Joe II, car crash, killed his aide. 1973, Ted Jr. had bone cancer and his leg amputated. 1974, Robert's son, David, died of a cocaine overdose, only 28 years old. In 1975, Robert's nephew, or 95, that was not that many years ago, nephew killed a woman and beat her to death with a golf club, charged with murder. 1997, Michael Kennedy died in a skiing accident in Colorado. John Kennedy Jr., the little boy that was so cute, grew up, good-looking guy, wife and sister-in-law, killed in a plane crash over the Atlantic just a few days after he was declared the first front runner for the New York Senate in 2011. Kara, 51, died of a heart attack, and they said, it's over. You want to study? Look at that story on the internet. I'm in no position to say God did this or God did that, but I know what that book said. It said, woe to a man or a family who makes his living off alcohol, and that family has had nothing but one tragedy right after another. I'm telling you, there's some things money ain't worth. There's some things that ain't worth what you get. There's some, if you make your money wrong or crooked or illegal or wicked, you know what the Bible said? It said, woe to him that builds a city with blood. This is what's called old-fashioned judgment preaching. You don't hear it much anymore. All you hear now is, God's good and he just loves you so much and he just adores you. The only thing good about you is when you're clothed in the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's it. If you endure chastening, the Lord dealeth with you as with son. I'm not the judge. I could have something terrible happen to me today. And I deserve it if I do. For all the sins I've committed in my past. And you do too. Well, stick your nose and your chest out there like you're something special. And God's lucky to have you. The Bible said he scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. You know what my advice to you to be this morning? Get your heart right and listen to preaching and keep yourself as straight and right as you can and avoid those whippings. People say, you know why people hate the police? Because they're doing something wrong. Well, these kids say, we hate cops, we hate cops. They've been taught to hate cops. You know why they've been taught to hate cops? Because they ain't doing right. And there's a few bad cops, like preachers, there's a few bad preachers, but the vast majority of them ain't like that. I don't know who God spoke to this morning, but I can promise you one thing. If you're doing something wrong and you're really saved, really saved. Now, you might not even be saved. I don't know. I can't judge that neither. But if you're honest to goodness, born again, know the real God, I mean you got the Holy Ghost inside you, and you're deliberately saying, I'm going to do this or I'm going to do that, you're asking for a whipping. And you're going to get it because God said you would. He chasteneth every son whom he receiveth. Every single one. And if you don't get it, you're not a child of God. So I'll leave it up to you. Let's stand by our heads for prayer.